Hello, Mr. True. Okay, we're going to graph some logarithms, but first we're going to graph an exponential function. I did this exact same one in a video just, about 20 minutes ago. I don't know when you watched it, even if you did, but at any rate, y equals 2 to the x. Okay, so I've picked out some x values that I want to plug into this function, and the reason why I'm picking my x values is because, well, the x is where the math has happened, and it's 2 to the x. So that's the easiest thing to figure out. So 2 to the negative 1 is 1 half, because 2 to the negative 1 power will move that base down to the bottom. Anything with 0 power is equal to 1. 2 to the first is 2. 2 second is 4. And 2 to the third is equal to 8. So we have negative 1, 1 half. Oh, forgot to put my tick marks on here. Hold on a second. Thought I was ready. Okay. Negative 1, 1 half. 0, 1. We've got 1, 2. And we've got 2, 4, and 3, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, and we talked about how exponential growth curves or decay, if they're in basic form y equals a to the x, that they have a horizontal asymptote of y equals 0. They all pass to the point of 1, 0, and because my base is larger than 1, it is growth. Awesome. Now, you heard me talk a little bit in the last video, if you watched it, about intro to logarithms, that logarithms and exponential functions are sort of reverse of each other. Log of 100 is 2, and the log base, actually let me clarify that, log base 10 of 100 is equal to 2, and 10 squared will undo that log function to get you back to 100. So they're inverse functions of each other. And how do you find inverse functions graphically? Like if I gave you this graph and said make the inverse function, what would you do? Well, hopefully you'd remember that you would take the x and y variables and flip them. So we're going to do that both graphically, but do it through the algebra to let you see it really develop. And remind you that if you want to find an inverse function, you flip the x and the y variables. So I'm going to take the x and y's and go x equals 2 to the y. Now, if I actually wanted to graph the inverse function, or not graph it, I am going to graph it. If I wanted to actually find the inverse function, I would have to resolve this for y. And I don't want to bother with that. I just want to graph the inverse function. Okay. There's something I was going to say and I just forgot it. Well, if I'm going to do a t-table to make this graph, what would I want to pick? Would I want to pick the x values and then, you know, try and solve for those with y? Well, if I pick the wrong x value, it's going to take me a logarithm to solve for the value of y, and we haven't gotten to the properties of logarithms and solving equations using logarithms yet. We're just trying to get used to them. So I definitely do not want to make this difficult. So what I'm going to do is pick my values for y, because again, the y is where the math is happening. If I want to just make a graph, I don't want to pick x and then have to solve for y backwards all the time. No, let's just, you know, I switch the x and the y's around a lot. Why don't we just pick the y's instead of picking the x's like we did before? And you might notice I'm using the same numbers again. So 2 to the negative 1 is again 1 half. 2 to the 0 is 1. 2 to the 1 is 2. 2 to the 4th is 4. And 2 to the 3rd is 8. So I'm saying the same thing that I just said a second ago, except what was my y values are now my x's and vice versa. Well, that's what you do when you graph an inverse function. Oh, now I remember what I wanted to say. And it's not this, but when you graph an inverse, it is a reflection over y equals x. And the reason, here's what I wanted to talk about. This white graph, this y equals 2 to the x, this exponential growth function, this will have an inverse function because not only is this a function itself, it would pass the vertical line test, but it would also pass the horizontal line test. This is a one-to-one function. I've talked about that concept and we've done this earlier this year as well. So if you're not sure about one-to-one function, go to my little search one in the upper right-hand corner and type in one-to-one and you'll see a video about that. So I want to reflect this now over the line y equals x. I want to graph the inverse function. So 1/2 negative 1, whoops, yellow, 1, 0, 2, 1, 4, 2, and 8, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 3. Okay, so there's my graph, whoop-de-doo. What used to be my horizontal asymptote of y equals 0 is now become my vertical asymptote of x equals 0. And you might start thinking to yourself, well, yay, Mr. Tree, you made a graph, but the title says graphing logarithms, and I don't see any logarithms up here. Well, yes, you do. First of all, this white line is exponential growth. This is the inverse of the exponential growth function. And so I say that this is the a graph of a log function, because the log function is the inverse of the exponential function. And I'm going to prove that to you by going to this equation and writing this equation that is in exponential form. And we're going to write that in log form. So log, maybe I should use the same color. Log, what's the base of the exponent? 2. So log base 2, log base in the exponential form, you're actually logging sort of the answer. So the answer was x. And if that was unclear, what did I chant in the last video? What do you get out of a logarithm? An exponent. What do you get out of a logarithm? An exponent. Why is a log of 100 equal to 2? Because it's 10 squared equals 100. So you get an exponent out of a logarithm, and voila. Y equals log base 2 of x. That is this graph. So in your textbook, if you're asked to graph a log function, you're going to want to actually not graph it as a log function, because you're probably going to have a base that you actually can't work with. Now, if it's y equals natural log or y equals just regular log of something, log of x, then you can put that in your calculator, like your graphing calculator. But if it's a base other than 10 or e, you're probably going to have to go into exponential form and then make a t-table and graph it. And you're going to pick the y values, not the x. So I've kind of actually graphed your log function without telling you I was. Pretty cool. Okay, so that yellow line is y equals log base 2 of x. Okay, so what if I wanted to graph y equals, let's pick a different color. How about y equals log base 2 of x minus 3? What would that look like? Well, if you have a plus or minus inside your math function, again, that's a horizontal movement left to right. And if it's minus 3, that's a shift to the right. So I can use this parent function to graph this function. Y equals log base 2 of x minus 3 is going to take all these points and move them over three places. This one, 1, 2, 3. This point over 1, 2, 3. This point over 3 units, this point over 3 units, this point over 3 units. It's in the middle, so it's going to be over here somewhere. And we get that. Good enough. Or if you were starting from scratch and you did not know what the parent function looked like, you could still write this in exponential form. This is 2 to the y equals x minus 3. Write that as 2y plus 3 equals x, and then still do your t-table and pick out your own y values. Okay, so there's a couple of ways to graph that. Now, let me erase all this stuff. and talk about some properties of these graphs for you before I run out of time. We'll just erase all this. And that was y equals log base, and it could be anything. It could even be natural log. But I'll keep it up like the log base 2 that we had up there a second ago. Actually, no, I'm not. I'm just going to put that as any base. Y equals log base b of x. It has all these graphs will pass through the point one, zero, not zero, one like the exponential growth and decay ones, but one, zero, because it's been reflected over the line y equals x. They have, instead of a horizontal asymptote, they have a vertical asymptote of x equals zero. Let's talk about that for a second. Well, let me finish this. They all pass through 1, 0. They all have a vertical asymptote of x equals 0, unless there's been, you know, a horizontal shift. They have a domain that is from 0 to infinity, because the vertical asymptote starts at 0 and goes to the right forever. And they have a range that is all real numbers. Negative infinity to positive infinity. Goes up and down forever, so all the y values are used. Again, unless there's a horizontal shift, why can you not log a negative number? Why is there no graph over here on the negative side of the x-axis? Well, let's see. Let's go back to that original graph I had up there of y equals log base 2 of x. And let's write that in exponential form, 2 to the y equals x. Why can there be no negative x's? Because the base is positive. And y is an exponent on that positive base. And let's say it's 2 to the second, 2 times 2, positive times positive. What if it was 3? Y was 3. 2 to the third, 2, 4, 8. See, the exponent tells you simply how many times to multiply by that positive base, and you're never going to repeatedly multiply by a positive number and get a negative answer. So thus, you can't log with a, you know, because logarithms must have a positive base by definition, so you cannot take the log of a negative number because that positive base of the log can be raised to no power and ever become negative. Even if it was y, let's say y was negative 1/2. Well, that's too hard. How about negative 2? Well, if it was 2 to the negative 2, it wouldn't come out to be negative. It would become 1 over 2 squared, which is 1/4. And again, it would be positive. So when you have a positive base, you can raise it to no power whatsoever that would ever yield a negative answer. And so thus the standard domain, again, there can be a horizontal shift, but the standard domain of log functions start at 0 and go to the right forever. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Woo! Go study. Go do your homework. Thank you very much for watching.